online shopping, everything can very easily function on Java 8, right? So basically, if you want to develop one website on Java, the development doesn't have any cost. You have a laptop, you have a desktop, pretty much development will not have any cost. Even, you know, the development tools, right? Those are also either freely available or the cost is pretty much less. Okay. Right. So if I go like 10, 12 years back, you know, because of this, you know, when I say that, okay, 7 out of 10 projects were using Java, right? These three were the main reasons. Okay. What next? The hosting platform. Now, what do I mean by hosting platform? See, every website has to be hosted somewhere, right? How do I access Amazon on my smartphone or on my web browser? That means it is hosted on some web server, okay? So that hosting is also one of the key criteria for, you know, for our clients, right? So Java hosting is, there are a lot of simple platforms available, doesn't need so much of technical competency, okay? Whereas for others, yes, the hosting platforms are a bit more complicated, right? So here also it's much more simple. And then advancements. See, back in mid 90s, since you know Java is there, okay, there has been lot and lot of advancements, right? If you ask today, yes, I can use Java for big data analytics, I can use Java for IoT, those points also I'm covering in subsequent slides, okay? But the advancements, you know, that means to keep pace with technology. Something new is there with some of the competitors. Yes, in Java also similar framework will be designed and will be launched, right? So that the client base who are using this technology need not look at any different technology. They will have that ready available packages to integrate. Okay, right. So an advancement, it just keeps on going. Right. And any competitor, maybe for some time, there will be some competition. Suddenly, you know, Java will have some better framework and it will win the race. And it is owned by Oracle. Right. Earlier, Sun Microsystems, they invented Java. Now it is Oracle product. OK, so that itself, you know, says that it is owned by one of the best IT company across the world. Right. And Oracle has its own database related lot of solutions. So being owned by Oracle means wherever you have Oracle database or related business packages, by default, Java will be compatible. OK. Right. And see, these providers are, again, you know, how they design these new advancements, say Oracle database. The way, you know, the speed and everything, the easy way how Java integrates with Oracle, you won't find this simple approach for any other programming languages. Yes, it can be integrated, but then the best would be Java. Right. So again, yes, that's where this why Java, our title of the slide, is very much justified. Okay. and there are the best frameworks for developing two-tier, three-tier or entire applications. Let me quickly tell you the core difference. What is two-tier, what is three-tier, what is N-tier? Okay. Tier means actual physical machine. A simplest website will always follow three-tier architecture. Why three-tier? So one, the first machine is the machine where we are accessing the website. Right, we will open browser, type whatever, facebook.com, amazon.in or so on. So that is the first machine comes into picture. Now that request goes to a web server where, you know, the data will be interpreted and some business logic will be written, correct? And then there will be some database related interaction. The third one, that is your data layer. Okay, maybe, you know, when you are purchasing an item, yes, your shopping cart will be created. It has to go to some database, right? So actual database will be your third machine. So that's where, you know, the simplest website will always have three tiers: the client machine, a web server, and a database. Okay. then what about two-tier? So in two-tier application are your desktop-based applications, I would say, right, where GUI and business logic, everything is there, which you can run, which runs on the same device basically, right, and then database will be something separate. And entire, now, see, three-tier is the simplest architecture of a website. As the website grows, this number of tiers are definitely going to increase. Okay, just take a simple a case of Amazon, you know. So when I'm searching for a product, let's say, I want to buy a smartphone. So I'll just put some entry, maybe, Samsung smartphone, and I'll hit enter. Correct? What will happen? You know, that request will go to the web server, right? Now, again, from that web server, it might just move to another next level of, servers. It will not directly go to database. Probably, there will be a logic written that the query is coming from Indian region, so let us divert to this particular server. Or the query will be interpreted, okay, it is for Samsung, so we have another server to take care of all Samsung related products, so let's just divert it to there. Correct? So each time, your request flows from one machine to another, right? And this defines how many tiers are there in your application. Okay. So that's where the best of frameworks are available in Java. So now, after this, why Java? Let us start from, what different type of applications we can build, starting with core Java. Okay. Now, what is core Java? Core Java means a basic Java program which has a main method, right? Finally, you just execute a main method and something will happen. So yes, what are different applications which we have seen in industry using core Java? As I gave you the example of your desktop applications, right? If you are working with Java, you are learning Java, you are studying Java, Eclipse. Eclipse is the IDE, the tool for writing Java code that is also built on Java. That is the desktop application. Okay. So desktop application can be one tier or two tier applications, right? Another example I can give is IBM Lotus Notes. Though it is an IBM product, the whole IBM Lotus Notes is built. It's a desktop application with Java. I can show you that because we are using it. Yeah, this is your IBM Lotus Notes. My own email client. Okay, so this one is also two-tier. Why two-tier? All logic and everything is here. So this one, see this window, what you see here, right? So this one is your IBM Lotus Notes. This is completely built with Java. Okay. Yes, so everything happens here. Only, the database and mail server, those are your, it comes in your second tier. Right? So likewise, there are multiple desktop applications. You can use the core Java language. Now next is content management tools. Let me give you one example. Content management means, there can be a lot of documents which are to be reviewed. Real-time example can be, you would have seen, right? When we say lawyer or attorneys, they have so many documents for a particular case and everything. Okay. How it is being showcased in our Indian movies, Hindi movies and all, they are still showing the old tradition that, okay, a lawyer will have a lot of files and all documents and pages and everything. There are a lot of advancements here, right? All Western countries, the paper does not exist. Okay, basically what will happen, all these documents will be scanned and then there are content management tools. So there will be a system in front of the lawyer or attorneys. They can just load the document. Each page will be loaded. They can review it. They can mark something, highlight something, right? And that is the standard way and a faster way of doing it. And it's a huge business also, right? But what I'm talking it is about the actual review tool, okay? The actual tool which these attorneys are using. Just think of, they want to search for something, they want to highlight something, okay? Right? They just want to pull few of those documents, create a zip file out of it, just send it as an email. So all those things are managed in one particular tool. Right? So that also you can build using your core Java technology. And then packages and libraries. Let's say, you know, there are libraries, I'm sorry for that spelling mistake. Actually, I just created this slide today morning. Yeah. So it's not, it's libraries over there. So libraries means, let's say you want to work with Excel file. Yes, please.
Sir, this is from Central University of Rajasthan. We can't see the slides actually.
I think others are able to see, so probably I'm not sure. There must be something at your end. Okay. Let me just push this button once again and again. Maybe, see, your audio video person should be able to help you. There must be some option in your remote. Okay, you just need to just press that remote. And so what is visible to you guys?
The video and the audio is clear, but we can't see any slide.
We can see you.
Okay, so I think, yeah, so that itself says that, in your remote, there must be one option. Right, there must be an option to switch that view. What about other colleges? You can see the slide, right? You can see the slide.
We can't see.
Okay, any college, the slide is visible?
It's not.
Okay. So some of the colleges it is visible, so definitely you just need to look at your remote control. Okay, anyways, even if the slides are not visible, you don't need to worry about, right? There is no Bahubali movie being played there. Okay. Right? I'm going to refer each and every topic, right? So please be on mute and, instead of referring the slides directly, I'll keep it in a different mode, right? Okay. So here, I was talking about core Java applications. So what I said was it can be used for desktop applications, content management tools, packages, and libraries. So when I say libraries means, let's say, you want to write a code which, let's say, works with Excel file. It will open the Excel file. It will read a particular, worksheet from a file. Maybe it will generate a chart out of it. Right. So those libraries can be written using Java, correct? Same kind of libraries you can also write for generating PDF files, right? Typically, all your MS Office has an option, print as PDF, okay? So even, there also you have a Java code being executed, correct? So those are your different packages and libraries. Now, you have heard about multi-threading concept. Just put a thumbs up if you have heard about multi-threading. Yeah, all right. So some of you know about it. You see, multi-threading means you can run your tasks in parallel. Okay. See, your CPU is way, way more powerful than what it seems like. Okay. So when it comes to running a small Java application, I don't think it will use more than 5% power of your CPU. Correct. So why, if things can be executed in parallel, can we just have split your execution using 20 separate threads so that we can use 100% power of the CPU, right? So those kind of multi-threading applications can be written with Java, okay? Directly not much used in these desktop applications, but yes, in image processing and you know all those advanced things, it is something must. Okay, and this multi-threading I have seen in Java and .NET. Okay, for other applications, it's I haven't seen any real-time application where multi-threading was being given by any other technologies. Right. So yes, if you want the power and capacity of your hardware, you are left with mostly Java and .NET. These two technologies. Yeah, C plus is there, right? But the limitation of C and C++, you know, you can't go beyond the system level programming. Okay, basically you can't build a website with C++. Okay, so Java also has a capability where you know you can interface it with something which is already written in other languages like C++ or C# or any other programming languages, right? So that capability you also have it. Then most you know of core Java we have also seen while running ad hoc scripts. Okay, now what are these ad hoc scripts? You all know, like you know, in IT industry there are roles like level 1 support, level 2 support. Okay, so they get some task that okay, from this bunch of files you find out the files which are modified between so and so dates, or you know files which contains these kind of keywords. So that's where they will use Java code, right? And it's pretty easy to use Java for your file management, right? Next is your database connectivity. So Java can connect with most of the databases available, okay, right? So Oracle anyways, it's own product. It can connect with SQL Server, MySQL, Postgres. Just think of a database, and Java has a driver to connect with those databases, right? Next, core Java I can share is about Java persistence. Okay, and there is another framework called Hibernate framework. Now, what is persistence? All of you understand database. You all have been working with one or other databases, right? Now see, what happens, you know, if you want to insert something in database, you have to write the whole insert query. If you want to select, you have to define whole select query, correct? This persistence layer will help you. I mean, it will give you a very sophisticated view of your database where each database table is represented as a class. Okay, so working with database that keeps on happening on the background, you are only writing Java code, correct? Say for example, you know, it will show you one class, you just create object of that class and the record gets added. You update say name or city or something in that object, background it will go and fire that update query, right? So that is your persistence layer, okay, which gives you, you know, the flexibility of using object-oriented programming, and on the background it does everything in your database. Okay, so this is something very widely used in industry, right? It's given by Java. Yes, it is also given by .NET. Okay, but yes, why still Java has an advantage in the industry? Why more projects are with Java? Because the spread of different databases where JPA can operate. Most of this .NET, you know, that it has its own similar layer that works better on your SQL Server, which is again .NET product, right? But for other databases, there are some, you know, different rules you need to understand. So these are the areas where core Java is being widely used in industries. Okay. But this was just the beginning. The major, even, you know, the core Java probably does only 10% maybe of the whole industry, then what is another 90%? So from another 90%, I would say the remaining 50-60% obviously is your web and your normal app development, right? So Java is known to, I mean, it's the best technology for developing web applications. Okay. So think of any website you are using, whatever features you see, Yes, there is a Java framework which can achieve that. Right, so I don't need to give examples of website every day. I mean, it's websites are our life now. That's what I can say. And then there are sophisticated frameworks which are gradually being developed. Okay, when say I was of your age, we started with servlets and JSP Java Server Pages. That was the old technology. And you will be surprised to listen this. Still, there are projects using those old technologies. Okay, still there are projects, right? So, and we have seen that if somebody has a good expertise with only JSP and servlets, yes, there is a project requirement. Okay, but then there are advancements. There is a Struts framework is there. You have JSF. You have the most widely used web framework called Java Spring. Okay, Java Spring is there since I would say more than 12, 13 years now, correct? And even like 12, 13 years back, even if you just if your resume said that okay, you have exposure to Java Spring, there won't be more questions asked. That was the demand. And today also Java Spring has equal demand, and so see these frameworks has all fun, it they are so much flexible and they can accommodate any other frameworks also. Say for example say a customer comes to you and say that I have this particular application running on .NET, right? I have this application running on PHP. I want to integrate these two applications. Okay, so all these frameworks, Spring, Struts, you can also build a bridge. These kind of applications also you can develop, right? So different frameworks, and your Java will be lying on the top, communicating with those different platforms. So those kind of projects are also there. Okay, right? Then integration with advanced user interface and gaming. I'm sure when you say gaming, all of you are pretty much into it, right? I'm sure. Okay, even if you deny somewhere, yes, everybody everybody is into gaming, right? Just think of the UI, to what extent your user interface has become more rich. Correct. So I'm not referring that Java can build that level of UI. No. For user interface, maybe that is the only limitation I can say for Java. You don't have that sophisticated libraries developed by Java to build such a sophisticated user interface. But interfacing with any of the advanced UI technology, you have best of frameworks available, right? So again, there also we have a lot of projects where UI is being designed in whatever. Even I don't know. I'm not good at UI, right? But I don't know. Maybe you must be knowing what different UI libraries are available. Some tools are available, right? What do they say? This not Photoshop, but there are tools to design these 3D characters, animations, and everything. Correct. So once that design is done. Right? See, UI is only going to design something. What about the interaction that you see in UI? Right? In your games like PUBG and everything, you are just running here and there. You will shoot somebody, a helicopter comes in. So what about that? Yes, helicopter is not designed in Java, right? But the speed at which the things are happening on the background, yes, the background code, again, Java comes into picture. Correct. So that's where again, it has its own market. For any kind of back-end events, when I say back-end means just after what is visible to you. Okay. In your mobile apps, yes, front layer is not Java. Those are all UI technologies, in any app. But what comes after that is your back-end. So Java is a proven middleware for all these kind of back-end activities. So any application, wherever you see, backend means the best framework is Java. right? Even if, let's say, taking example of Paytm, say I am transferring some amount to let's say to Mangesh, okay. So what happens, you know, in my Paytm screen, I will click somewhere. What happens when I click? The request goes somewhere and Java or similar language comes into picture, right? So now that framework, the whole logic is written, which will read from the database, from my account. Okay, so much amount is there, you deduct so much amount, you add that amount into Mangesh account, and then you send the confirmation back. So this is your backend event. Okay, so Java is the best proven middleware for all these backend events that exist in IT industry. Okay. And then comes your Android development. Yes, you need to be good at Java programming if you want to learn Android. Right. So that's where, you know, it has, again, whatever apps you are being developed for Android, definitely, you know, Java is there. You would have heard about distributed applications, right? And, you know, basically where your application is either deployed in multiple systems or, you know, like the data analytics tools like Hadoop and MapReduce. So basically, you know, what these tools will do, maybe we can refer this as one higher version of multi-threading. When I say multi-threading, your application is divided into small processes to take power of one CPU. Now, what if you have 10 CPUs? Okay, you have 10 CPUs and there is a huge chunk of, let's say there is terabytes of data to be processed, correct? Then comes your tools like Hadoop and MapReduce, purely being, using Java as a technology, right? It is so much sophisticated that you just need to enter that, okay, so many systems are there. This is the data, this is the logic to process. And it will divide the chunk of data to all those systems. Final result will be accumulated, taking the power capacity of the whole distributed environment, right? So that the whole application, and again for data analytics, this is Hadoop and MapReduce has been there in industry since almost 8-9 years now, correct? And a lot of it is being used, right? Then, if I talk about microcontroller, right? I think if you are from electronics background, this is a very well-known term to you guys, microcontroller, where you have some assembly code which is written inside a microcontroller, and all our electronic devices, it is something must, right? You talk about washing machine or you talk about air conditioner, it will have its own microcontroller chip where some code logic will be written in assembly language. Now, there are Java libraries. There are Java libraries. What happens, you know? Suppose if I know Java programming, I want to write code for a microcontroller, which is actually in assembly programming, correct? I will write the whole logic in Java. Okay, I will have my input parameters. Maybe, okay, this is a variable which will hold temperature. This is for pressure. This is for your, you know, number of rotations, whatever, right? All if else for loop, I will write down with Java code, which will be tested on a simulator, correct? And that whole library will generate assembly code, which will be directly fed into the microcontroller, correct? So I don't need to worry about all those assembly codes or anything. I will keep doing my stuff with Java. Okay. And when I say microcontroller, now that microcontroller and your BLSI thing, the new latest technology on the top of that is your IoT, Internet of Things, right? So that's where, yes, again, Java has its own hold for each and every IoT application you see, right? Say, for example, you know, sitting over here from my smartphone, say, I want to switch on AC at my home. Okay, I want to switch on AC at my home. This is possible only through IoT, correct? My phone has internet, okay? My home Wi-Fi is connected to air condition, right? And there will be some way through which, through internet, I can fire commands from this phone, right? So where Java comes into picture? Say when I'll open some app, I will select that AC and I'll just select switch on, right? So now through internet, right, that particular Wi-Fi router will be identified, which is connected, okay? And then there will be some IoT chip, which will again divert that request to air conditioner. Okay, and then air conditioner will start working. So the whole logic, you know, that on, off, measuring your maintaining temperature, everything, when it would have happened for the first time, right? The whole logic would have been written in Java, and then ultimately it transfers into that respective assembly language, right? And then, you know, there will be some intermediate databases where all these parameters will be stored, most likely in my router. Okay, so router will have one device attached where all these parameters and everything will be stored, right? But the core programming is your Java over there. So that was about IoT. Next is about web services. Okay. Anybody knows any idea about web services? What is a web service? Can you give me one example? Yes, please. Give me one example of web service. Not a web application. I'm talking about web service.
Amazon,
Amazon is a web service or web application?
Web service, Amazon,
AWS. AWS, okay. Why do you call it a web service? Yeah, why do you call it a web service? Okay, Amazon Web Service is a name given to something that is your Amazon Cloud, right? So it is basically a cloud service. Here, what I'm talking about web service is, let's say, you know, your geolocation, right? Google provides something. Okay, you can see wherever you are, how that your Google Map works, how it is identifying the location. There is a live web service. There is a live web service where you just need to specify the, latitude, longitude, and then, you know, it is mapped and it will tell you which city where you are. Correct. So web service is something, you know, it doesn't have any graphical user interface, but it works on input and output parameters. So, you know, if you want, you can build a simple web service of a calculator. Correct. Just build a web service, host it on some server, right? And anybody in the world can use it. Okay. They will pass the input parameters two, and then they'll pass third parameter, whether addition, subtraction, division, multiplication, and your service will run the logic and give the answer. Now, this is very simple example. Likewise, there are n number of services existing. Correct. Even your, I think IRCTC also has their own web services. You can check on Google. Okay. So it's basically, you know, you can build your application consuming those services. Right. You can build your application consuming those services. Okay. Even this air, your airlines, the flight control and everything, there also you will find a lot of web services. You enter the flight number and date, and it will show you, the service will return back, what is the status of that flight? Okay. It will also return where it is. Correct. And probably if you get the professional, access, that means, you know, they will charge for you. Maybe, you know, they'll also give you the geolocation of that flight. Correct. So how this flight tracker and all these tools are, these websites are working, they are consuming those web services. Okay. So when I say web service, yes, again, Java is the best technology to build and host your web services. Now, what is the specialty here? The specialty is you cannot guarantee that the calling application will be using which technology framework. Okay. My web service is in Java, which I am hosting. Now, calling application can be .NET, can be PHP, can be Python, can be anything else, right? So basically, you know, it has to agree on that input and output protocols. Correct. So that's where, you know, Java has a pretty good support. There are two protocols for web services, REST protocol and SOAP. For both these protocols, yes, Java has the best support available. And that's why it is, again, very widely used for these different kind of web services. Okay. So after core Java, this whole area of web application, your Android apps, your web services, microcontroller distributed, this becomes maybe another 60% of coverage with Java, right? So far we have reached, let's say, 70%. So then what is the next 30%? Okay. So that's where we talk about cloud, DevOps, and microservices, the recent advancement in IT industry. When I say recent, means probably last 3 years or so. This is something very, pretty much, in demand right now. So before, since I'm not going to cover anything on actual Java programming, it's better that we understand these cloud DevOps and microservices as a concept, because that knowledge definitely, will help you in your studies as well as, whatever career you would take up, right? So what I'm going to discuss here is why these technologies are suddenly in so much of demand. And plus, what exactly it is. Cloud, all of you understand. Cloud means, kind of infrastructure as a service, right? It's a virtual PC somewhere. It could be, if I'm using Google Cloud, then yes, I'm using that Google machine, which is somewhere in the world. It's not my machine. If I'm using Amazon Cloud, yes, I'm just using that machine, right? For whatever purpose I want. I want to host a website. I want to just dump off my files, right? Even your Google Drive. Google Drive is actually a cloud application. You are putting your files. Okay, so that is cloud. So cloud, all of you understand. But then what is this DevOps and microservices, which actually works on cloud? That is what, let us spend few minutes around that. Okay. Let us start with DevOps. Anybody has, any idea on how the changes are managed in IT, any of the IT application? Say one application is running, correct? And then let's say there are some changes to be done. A new version has to be updated. So what is the background process that happens in that project? And how things are managed? Anyone has this idea? See, any application that is running, even if you talk about the current, you just open Amazon in your smartphone, there is a live version of that application, correct? So somewhere in a version control repository, where now most widely used is your Git repository, right? In Git repository, the latest version of your code will be placed, correct? That will be the live version of that application. Now, before this DevOps and microservices concepts, what used to happen? Let's say I have to change one application. Suppose your whatever banking application, Axis Bank, HDFC, or ICICI. Let's say some change came up. That, okay, in the user login page, we want to put two extra text boxes and all that. Okay. So it was a huge process in the background. Right, it was not so easy that, okay, you just put a text box and within next minute things are up and running. No, that never happened, correct? Because there is one live latest version of code. Okay, any change means you have to come up with the new version of that entire code. So change is only for 2-3 lines. Code lines are, let's say, only 5 or 10, right? The whole application is, let's say, 5 lakh or a million lines of code. But even a small change means you have to come up with a new version, right? The existing version has to go down. So there is a downtime. And that's why, still we keep on getting messages like our servers will not be accessible. Typically it happens overnight, okay? Yeah, so then the server is stopped. New version which is developed, which is completely tested, that version goes on the Git repository and then again it is switched on. Right? So even a small change, the time duration used to be in minimum in hours to days or weeks or months also. Right? Sometimes just adding one extra page to your website, the whole cycle probably used to take 2 weeks' time. Okay. Now, what happened with DevOps and microservices? So let us understand DevOps. See, DevOps is this automation of these background processes. Right? Take an example. Take an example. Say I'm waiting for my flight at the airport. Okay. Now I am the developer. I am the developer for the ICICI Bank, the main portal, right? So I'm part of that development team. Then suddenly I receive a message from my lead that in this particular page, let's say these three text boxes are to be added and this message has to be changed. Correct? I will see that, okay, my flight, I still have 1 hour left. I will open my laptop. Correct? Fine. I will open the environment where the code is to be written. On one click, the latest application code will reach, you know, will be ready in my laptop. I will make all those changes. Right? And I'll just hit one button called check-in. The moment I will hit that button from my laptop, the latest code goes into Git repository. Automated test cases are there. It will be executed, right? If all test cases are successful, then the latest code will automatically go as the next version. It will give a signal to the live code to hold for a while, maybe few seconds, and the final code will be up and running. Okay, so all these steps of automation, so this comes under DevOps, right? Yes, I said it's a complete automation, but yes, there is some human intervention also. But at least see, what used to take weeks or days, now probably it will take half an hour or 1 hour time, right? But still, this was not enough, and hence came the concept of microservices. In the same scenario which I told you just now, right, that adding two text boxes and changing one particular message, it is just one page of my huge application. Agreed? The change is applied only to one particular page. It's not applied to the whole application. But why these things are getting more complicated in terms of time? Because when it comes to deployment, it is the whole application at a time. Got it? The actual deployment is for the whole complete application at a time, and that's why I have to switch off the whole ICICI application and make it live. But the change was just in one small page, that's all. Right? So looking from this perspective, what is the bottleneck here? The bottleneck is I have deployed the whole application as one unit. Instead, can I break down that application? Say, you know, I will have one small application just for deposit, one small application for withdrawal, one small application for credit card, one small application for fixed deposit, and so on. I'm just giving you an example, right? So the whole ICICI banking application will no longer be one huge application. Rather, it will be collectively 100 small applications running in parallel. Okay, so doesn't matter, I will have 100 different versions. Each small application will have its own version, right? Doesn't matter to me. So now what is the advantage? I just have to take care of that one small piece of application, not the huge application. Okay, right? And this also gives me a flexibility. Now from here, let me jump to Amazon, right? Because Amazon is the best platform using microservices. So what happens in Amazon? even see these particular services, I can scale up and scale down, taking the advantage of cloud. You all, if you have studied even the basic theory of cloud, you know what is scale up and scale down, right? Scale up means I will give a request, I need 5 systems. Automatically, cloud will assign those 5 systems to me. Next day, I will give a request, no, I want to scale down to 1. It will take the 4 resources. And I will be charged for 5 resources for 1 day, right? So similar scale up, scale down can also happen for the applications which are deployed. Okay, so now 100 applications are deployed. So 2 applications out of those, I just want to scale it up. Okay, that is possible, right? So this is this in a nutshell, I have given you the idea of how DevOps and microservices works. And it is because of you know, this fitment, you know. So this is something every client is now asking for. And that's why, you know, it is so much prominent in the industry. Now, coming to Java, yes, it has the best in-class support for cloud automation, right? Software as a service, that is also possible. The whole DevOps automation, which I talked about. And then in terms of microservices, right, there is its own framework, Spring Boot framework. You can just take down that name in future if you are interested, right? See, I'll tell you this, expertise in Spring Boot itself can take you to next level of your career, right? I'm openly making this statement right now. Okay, it is in so much demand, it will have its own demand, okay? And then there is, Java has its own cloud framework also, which is called Spring Cloud, right? And there is another concept of dockerizing your applications, which probably we have enough time to cover, right? But just, you know, I want all of you to take down this term. One is Spring Boot framework, and second one is Docker containers, D-O-C-K-E-R, Docker containers, okay? Because this Docker container is the latest, I would say it's a revolution in the IT industry. Right, it's a huge revolution. Correct. Since, you know, because if I start talking about it, it will take at least 1 hour just to understand what is it, and that's why I'm not getting into that. But just, you know, whenever you get a chance, open YouTube and just look at any video on Docker which is of 1 or 2 minutes. You will understand what is it. Okay, you will understand what is it, right? And then the next point which I am sharing with you is Java platform has the best fitment for Docker containers. Something which I would refer as the revolution in IT industry, and Java has the best fitment, right? So yeah, that's all I wanted to share with you guys. Okay, as I said, since, you know, we did not touch base into any of the for programming aspect of Java, just wanted to give you a broader view that how wide Java technology is spread in this industry. Right. Having said that, if you have any questions, I can take up. Seems all of you are hungry. Your lunchtime?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Vishal, you can take off from the projector mode.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, being in this industry for so long, one thing I realized since last few years, always take your lunch around 11:30 a.m. Okay. That will help you. Right? It never gives you that you know, post-lunch kind of feeling, right? So here also, you know, I came here after my lunch, right? Yeah, but I realized a few years back, so it's an input for you guys, if you are building a career in IT. Yes, guys, yeah, questions from you.
Hello, sir.
Yes, please.
This is Abhishek Kumar from Central University of Rajasthan.
Yes, Abhishek, tell me.
Sir, as we are studying data science, we are going to use Java. Actually, we see that Python is more easy for making data science project and using machine learning projects. How can we use Java as a substitute for Python?
Okay, looking from industry perspective, specifically for data science and Python, as of now, I will recommend Python. Okay. As of now, for data science and machine learning, I would straight away recommend to study Python. Correct? Because see, Python has lot of ready-made, you know, we talked about packages and libraries. Now for Java, I was completely referring web application, desktop and all that. I did not refer anything on data science and machine learning. Because there is a reason. Java doesn't have that much of the support. And even the support is there, but the speed at which, you know, your Python packages can process and give you all visual representations and everything. So far, that level of sophistication is not there. Okay. So instead of just, you know, digging down and trying to find something from Java, if you are interested in data science and machine learning, better you focus more on Python. Okay. But if your interest is towards web application development, Android development, cloud, and this kind of automations, then Java is the best. Right? See, we always say this way, Java comes into picture for building your application from a scratch to deploying, right? And once the data starts generating, the rest of the things, see this machine learning and data science, the core input is your huge set of data, correct? That's where Python comes into picture, right? But again, distributed processing, which I said, that's where Hadoop, MapReduce, yes, that is again Java-based. But see, the purpose is just distributing your actual processing, correct? Let's say, you know, you want to search some keywords from a Word document, and let's say you have 50 million Word documents, okay? You have 50 million Word documents, and you want to write a code to search maybe Tata Consultancy Services, and just want to find out that so many documents has this particular term. Right? Now, here there is nothing like machine learning or data science. Okay, this is not machine learning or data science. Right? But if you just write a simple Java code, 50 million means, you know, probably it may take, I don't know how much time it will take. Right? So there you have distributed processing, you can leverage this MapReduce, Hadoop architecture, you have 50 systems in with you. So it will assign 1 million document to each system, and all those parallel processing can happen, correct? But when I say machine learning, it's all about understanding the patterns, right? From the data, what pattern is there, it will give you, it will highlight that, okay, this data is showing this kind of patterns, and you come up with your own this classification algorithms and everything. For that, Python is the best technology, all right?
Thank you.
Yes, guys, any other questions? Yes, please. Yes, you are audible.
Sir, this is Sumit from Central University of Rajasthan. Sir, since you have talked about multi-threading, I want to know the difference between multi-threading, concurrency, and parallel processing.
Okay. Parallel processing is a concept, right? Parallel processing is a concept. Anything you can execute in parallel, that's what it says. All right? Okay. Now, what happens in multi-threading? See, parallel processing, even multi-threading also use parallel processing. Take it that way, right? But when I say parallel processing means, let's say if my hardware has 5 CPUs, right? I can split a task and give chunk of that task to each CPU. Theoretically, I can do that. And I can run it on each CPU. That is parallel processing. What happens in multi-threading, you are going beyond a process. Okay. See, basically process is the smallest unit that can be executed by your CPU from your operating system perspective, right? Threading means you are going one level down. Beyond process, there is something called a task, and that happens only through this kind of programming languages. Okay, right? So your CPU will understand it's a process, but actual process has, let's say, 20 threads. Okay, actual process will have 20 threads which your programming layer will manage. All right, and your actual the logic which you have written is splitted into those 20 threads, and there it is running in parallel. So that is multi-threading, right? And when you say concurrency is like, let's say, you know, two things running parallel trying to access third thing. Okay, two things running parallel need one particular resource, right? So which thread or which process should be assigned first, that is concurrency. So there again, you know, there are its own internal algorithms that when first thread comes, it will lock that resource, thread has to release, then and then it will give it to something else. All right.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, sorry. Yes, guys. More questions?
Yes. Hello, sir. This is Saurabh from Central University of Rajasthan.
Yes, Saurabh.
Sir, I wanted to ask you, what do you think the future of Java is? Actually, sir, in context of web development, they are embedding ML and AI in web development web applications. So, what do you think will web development will move to Python or Java will adapt ML and AI in context of
Windows? Okay. Yeah. So see, now even Python is coming up, has its own frameworks to develop web applications, right? Django is there. And yeah, some projects are asking for it. But still, see, I don't see any way that demand of Java will go down, right? See, the reason is right now in Python, there is a better support for machine language, AI, data science, everything. Correct? But on the other side, if you see, majority of all these web applications, these tools are running on Java. Correct? So sooner, Java will also come up with its own frameworks. Right? If we look at the web development for Python, it is there. You can build a website with the basic features, but you know, the other concepts which I talked about, this microservices, Docker, and so on, no other technology has reached to that level. Correct? So, see this, now Java being product of Oracle, right? They are not going to just get isolated that, okay, currently we don't have support for machine language, so let's not look into that. Research must be in progress. Sooner we will find all such tools and everything, right? Or you never know, Oracle can just do a tie-up with Python that, okay, for machine language and AI, Python is our business partner, correct? So all these possibilities are there. But there is no way I can see that the web framework for Python or any other technology can replace Java. That is not going to happen, right? Even, you know, 20 years back also, demand was there. Today also, actually today, if you see, because of all these advancements, the demand is more, right? So I don't see demand will go down anyway, correct? But yes, if you are asking like this way, if you are interested in data science and those things, then better, you know, you learn Python right now, correct? Because see, in your career, you can't be You can't do everything together, right? You cannot be a web developer also, a microservices developer also, or DevOps automation also, and data science and AI. That is not going to happen. In this field, you have to select at least one or two such sophisticated areas. Okay. One or two areas you select, you deep dive into those. Right? So latest trends I have shared with you in this techno, the core technology group, latest one is cloud DevOps microservices. Yes, web development is there, will remain. App development, Android, it will remain. All those things will remain, but those are latest. And other, these new technologies, AI, machine learning, and data science, it is also there. Correct? IoT again, that is another area. So select one or two areas and then you can deep dive. So I hope I have answered to your query.
Hello, sir. I'm Anirudh from Central University of Rajasthan.
Yes, tell me.
Sir, you have talked about Android Studio and Java. People should be aware of Java when you're using Android Studio, right? So when you're comparing with Kotlin, which is far more efficient than Java, writing a program in Kotlin and Java is completely different. So what is your take when you're comparing Kotlin versus Java?
Okay, I've never used the other technology which you are referring, right? So that's where I cannot comment anything. Okay. But see, I'll tell you this way. selecting Java versus any other technology which has very, very limited fitment as of now, right? If you learn Java, it's not only Android is the career option. Right, you have a lot more to do as a career, correct? But yes, if you feel that other technology is better, you are more comfortable, correct? And that technology can achieve whatever, you know, the best is available in the market. So that level of, complexity as well as user interface, the speed and everything can be achieved, then there is no problem. You can even explore that technology, right? But as you said, it is only for Android, right? So that's where, from career perspective, you have to think over that. Okay, questions from other colleges? I've got all questions from Central University. Okay, no questions from any other college? Yeah, looks like.
Surprising. Only Central University of Rajasthan has been listening to the session, is it? The request came from Ramakrishna Mission, actually, for this class. And no questions from your side? Yeah.
All these areas are comparatively new, correct? And when we say industry demand always comes from customers, right? It always starts from that, your existing customer would come and say that, okay, I want to do this kind of things because I have a lot of data, right? So see this machine learning, deep learning, actually, deep learning is again subset of machine learning, right? AI, artificial intelligence, see, if you see the common application of AI, I have not seen going beyond simple chatbots, honestly. Okay, in actual IT industry, when we are, you know, our we are developing websites and, you know, all these things, from AI point of view, what we see is a chatbot, right? So what more would come up, even we are not sure. Okay, even we are not sure. Many applications, though they are referred as AI, actually they are not AI. They are more often, you know, kind of process automations. Okay. Earlier there was a person to do it, and now some logic is written and it can be done, right? Which they might be referring that, okay, that is AI. But except the chatbot thing, which to some extent it is interpreting your language and trying to do something, so far AI has not matured that much. But yes, machine learning, recently I have seen much of the applications. Many clients are asking for it because, you know, they have data. Correct. So see, AI is more from process point of view, machine learning, analytics, right? These are all from data point of view. So data keeps on piloting, correct? And data will have something to reflect upon, how to improve and all that, right? So first I can see that, yes, data science would come up. Okay. By the time, maybe some more practical advancements of AI will be visible and that might come up. Right, but next few years are purely, you know, more towards data science in terms of core IT industry, right? But if you think from research point of view, big research firms and everything, they will have AI and everything in their plate. Okay. Right. Must be there. Honestly, I have not explored. Correct. See, compatibility wise, now how, where things are moving, I'll tell you. Maybe the slide was not visible to you guys. I mentioned that there are two protocols for web services, SOAP and REST. Okay. Now, REST is very easy to integrate. There is a protocol REST, R-E-S-T. And if you know about JSON format, okay. When you say, you know, compatibility with a platform means what? You can talk to that platform. Your application written in Java can talk to something written in Python. Correct? Now, rather than, you know, writing something in Java and compiling in Python, anyways, Python, you can't compile it, but passing it there and interpreting there, basically converting that to Python, that becomes very complicated task. Instead, okay, this is a Python layer, this is Java layer. There is a REST protocol support for Java. You build a REST protocol support on the top of Python. So whatever data you want to get, it comes into JSON format. And that's how things can be very easily integrated. So things are moving towards that direction. Okay. And that's why, you know, we never thought of that, okay, do we have some kind of libraries which you are referring, where something in Java can be converted to Python and that way some compatibility can happen, right? There is no more demand for exploring such things. See, being a data science student, right, your core thing is data, correct? Your core thing is data. Now, what is science? Science doesn't tell you that, you know, you have to write 1 plus 1 equal to 2 kind of logic, right? It's all about to what level of complexity you are trying to solve looking at the data. Agreed? Right? So, the answer is straight and simple also, and answer is equally complex also. It's like wherever you are stuck, you are trying to search something. Okay, you are trying to search something. You find out, and if you see that, okay, there is a Java library which can do this, okay, you do some research, trial and error around that library. And if you want to use it and your another component is with Python, go for this kind of REST-based interaction. JSON-based interaction between both layers. Okay, so as I said, it's complex also and simple. Simple why? Because the answer is okay. On need basis, you have to explore. Right. See, since many of you have referred that, okay, you guys are studying data science, then don't just stick to one technology. Yeah, Python is going to be your core technology if you are into data science, right? But sometimes, you know, as I have answered to him, sometimes you will get some library where Java has ready-made solution, correct? Accept it, build it. Look at this REST protocol. It is very easy to integrate, correct? So JSON will be the format for passing data from Python to Java and getting back. And your things will be done. Okay. Yeah, more questions? Okay, probably over to you, Mangesh, then. I don't see more questions now.
Okay, so no more questions, right? From any of you?
So one last question from Central University of Rajasthan.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, if you were asked to build an application, a basic application of something particular to some field, so there are lots of softwares and applications that provide this option of drag and drop option to select an attribute. And would you prefer to do an application using Java, or would you prefer a drag and drop option software and application to build a program to build a project?
Okay, I will look at from broader perspective. See, if the application is just to build one page and some logic, and I am 100% sure that it will not expand in future, correct? Then maybe I'll just look at some drag drop and quickly do it, correct? But if the application has a different, you know, a broader sense in terms of there will be multiple pages, right? The database goes beyond three or four tables. That is another measure I'll probably put in, right? And then I'll also see that, okay, what is the like the hosting and the accessibility point of view? How many users will be accessing? So anywhere, if it goes beyond a small number, I'll directly go and use Java. But then, as I said, see, this drag drop, these tools, everything, you can interface with Java. Okay. So your UI is actually built with something else, and your backend can be completely Java. I'll probably go with that approach. Right?
Okay, St. Xavier's, Bombay and Ahmedabad, no questions from your side?
Sir. I am Rahul Rathod from St. Xavier's, Bombay. Hello, sir.
Yeah, yes.
Sir, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, sir, I had a question that how does Java help in cross-programming integration? Like if I want, like Java has certain applications which some other language may not have or some other programming language may have. So how does Java help in integrating the two of them?
So this is something, you know, the same thing which I answered previously when a question came up of, you know, whether like how Java fits into data science and so on, right? See, there is a... if you see, you know, I talked about web services, right? So that's where you have this JSON format. And what happens, you know, whatever the other application does, you have to convert that information into JSON format which Java can consume. And the response of Java will again be converted into JSON format which the other application can consume. Correct? All right. So that's how you will have a common protocol for communication. Rest of the logic is anyways internal.
All right, sir. Thank
you, sir. Thanks.
Sir, I'll call you back.
Any other questions? Yes, sir. Sir. Java is good for web technology, but nowadays Django is also in high demand. So, what you can say, which one to choose, Java or Django?
Okay, so again, depending upon what complex and you know, the spread of your application, right? And see, typically if you ask me what will I choose, I don't have any choice. Our customers will choose. Okay, they will come and say that no, we want to this to be developed with Django, we have to do it, right? But yes, if I am the customer and I want my application to be designed, correct? See, Django, yes, it gives you the basic platform to host and build and host an application. But what about the other things? When I say other things, means putting on the cloud, coming up with all these microservices, the DevOps automation part, integration with the Git repository. So that I'm not much comfortable, even if Django says, yes, we have those, which is not proven yet. Okay. Fine. So yes, for web application, I will go with Java. Probably I cannot answer that question, okay, because what I came to know is the whole internship process has been changed. There is I think in career portal you have to share your details and maybe you know
sorry,
you called for a
I
test and everything
question,
but I'm not the right person. Yes, Mangesh,
sorry, I missed that question. What was that?
He's asking for like what is, yeah, please go.
See, that is for a different session and a different day. This is dedicated entirely for Java and its applications. Okay, so that you can also check with Professor Swati Prabhu, he'll also be able to answer you. All right. Any other questions? Or we close the session? Okay, thank you so much, Vishal. I'm sure the students found your session very valuable. And any feedback that you want to give, Vishal? Guys? Do we have Professor Vikas there, or Professor Swati Prabhu, or Professor Hemal?
Bye. Bye, sir.
Sorry?
Yes, Mangesh, I'm here.
Sir, you want to say something?
Overall,
sir, we can't hear you.
Hope
everyone must be getting benefit, some sort of benefit for this session. Okay, Professor Swati Prabhu, are you there? Is he there? Okay, I think Professor Hemal is also not there. Okay, fine. I hope you all had a good session, right?
Yes, sir.
Something for you to take back after this 1.5 hours of session.
Indeed.
Right? Okay, I'd like to thank Vishal again for his time. Vishal, I'm sure we would request for more such sessions on different topics from your side. Hopefully, you'll be available.
Yeah, sure. thanks, Mangesh. Thanks to all of you. So you can now go and enjoy your lunch. Okay?
Yeah.
Thanks, man.